We are tracking four significant wildfires this afternoon all across the inland northwest. South of Spokane, the Asotin Complex fire, made up of two fires actually. Also the Wilma fire, both located right around Clarkston.
Closer to us is the Andrus Fire that is burning in the West Plains near Cheney, and across state lines in the Silver Valley is the Mission Flats Fire. This is near the Cataldo Mission off of I-90 in North Idaho. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us on Crempton News First at 4. I'm Tom Sherry.
It's good to have you with us today. I'm Whitney Ward. So let's get right to it. The Andrus Fire is still burning. It's charred about 230 acres so far out near Cheney. All of the level 2 and 3 evacuations have been lifted. Right now there are only level 1 evacuations still in place, and that's right next to Andrus Road. So that just means that those people need to watch the situation closely and be ready to act if the situation changes. Right now, fire officials say that brush fire started on Monday. It's about 30% contained as of today. Crews are still working on trees that have burned in that area, and they're taking care of the ones that are ready to fall. Roadblocks do remain in place for Thomas Mallon between Melville and Andrus Roads. Only local residents will be allowed past those roadblocks.
Meanwhile, the Asotin Fire has grown to more than 27,000 acres. This wildfire is made up of two fires called the Dry Gulch Fire and the Silcott Fire. The Silcott Fire is only 10% contained, and the Dry Gulch Fire is at 0% contained. Level 3 evacuations are in place for the Asotin Creek Road west of Cloverland Fork. So that means if you live in this area, you need to leave right now. Level 2 evacuations are also in place for the Cloverland Road area, as well as the Harlow Ridge area. In Clarkston Heights, Peola Road and Critchfield Road to Asotin Creek are also at a level 2 evacuation. A shelter is now open at Lincoln Middle School in Clarkston. Livestock and large animals can be taken to the livestock market there.
And in Whitman County, crews are still working to contain the Wilma Fire. This is near Clarkston. That fire grew to 14,325 acres. Officials say it's about half contained right now. It is currently burning in grass and brush. The Douglas County Sheriff's Office says all level 2 and 3 evacuations have now been reduced to level 1. That's for Wilma Road. The cause of that fire remains under investigation.
And in Idaho, the Mission Flats Fire near the Cataldo Mission has grown to about 102 acres. The fire located west of the boat ramp between I-90 and the Coeur d'Alene River. Now the mission is not being immediately threatened, and at this point no other structures are threatened. It did stop I-90 traffic yesterday for a time being. The Idaho Department of Land says for drivers going eastbound on I-90 to use extreme caution.
And if you would like to know more about any of these fires or new ones that do pop up, or those ever-changing evacuation orders, just text the word fire to 509-448-2000 and we will send that link directly to your phone.
Well, since July 1st, the Spokane County Medical Examiner's Office has identified 17 heat wave related deaths here in Spokane County and 3 probable cases. And the deaths range in ages from 26 to 84. Most were found alone in houses or apartments without air conditioning. Some were found in buildings where other people were also suffering from heat related illnesses. The medical examiner's office says that many of the people who died also had underlying health conditions.
So we know the heat is continuing also to cause roads to buckle across Washington. Crews were out this morning working on emergency repairs to Highway 395, the southbound bridge over the Little Spokane River. That's up in North Spokane. The heat caused significant bumps in the road. Officials say the road buckling is caused by thermal expansion. So certainly the heat has been a factor. Today was the day that we were trying to decide or wait to see if we were going to maybe tie that record or how many days 90 and above we might end up having.
Yeah, consecutive 90 degree days today would have been 15, which would have tied the record.
Okay.
And as you can see on your screen, we're at 86 degrees right now. So we've still got another 2 hours or so, at least an hour, 90 minutes of good daytime heating. But it would, we may not break the record or tie the record today, which is a little bit of a shame, because if we had tied the record today of 90 degrees, we would smash the record, because for the next 7 days or so, we expect to see temperatures in the 90s, maybe even getting close to 100 degrees by Saturday. So we'll look for 80s this evening, 61 the overnight low. Again, Friday, sunny and hot. We're up to about 93 degrees. Could even see some isolated thunderstorms in the panhandle of Idaho tonight. At least it gets down to 61 tonight. And then Saturday, 99 degrees. That means It's probably downtown and in the Spokane Valley. We will hit 100 and then 96 expected on Sunday. The rest of your 7-day forecast just minutes away.
I was going to say it's a little misleading when we think about not breaking that record,
right?
Because it's not really indicative of how hot it's
it
been.
Is. Yeah, when we look at the average of like all of June and July, we might be talking records there.
Wow. All right, Tom, thanks very much. Well, this is a widespread issue all across Spokane right now. Rents are going sky high. Many landlords are raising costs, in some cases by more than 100%.
So we had two big questions we wanted to get answers to. So what exactly are landlords allowed to do legally speaking? And why are the rents this rate rising so much? We begin now with Casey Decker, who looked into it. Casey.
Yeah, guys, I'll start with that second question. Why are landlords raising rent so much right now? I spoke with the president of the local landlords association, who said there are a plethora of factors at play.
The first reason, demand for housing is shooting up as Spokane grows.
I think there's just a lot more people that can live here now because so many more jobs are, you know, work from home.
Second, says Daniel Clemmy, supply is going down. People who owned homes that they rented out are now selling those houses given the hot market, leaving less spaces to rent. Third, landlords aren't looking to recoup money that they didn't get during the pandemic.
The eviction moratorium, there was a significant amount of non-payment of rent. And so I think that this is, for a lot of landlords, you know, some of them have tenants that haven't paid that owe, you know, $15,000 to $20,000. And so the only thing they can think to do to try to get some of the, recapture some of that profit or even just to break even is to raise the rents on all their units.
Clemmy also blames new state laws that create more protections for tenants and restrictions on landlords.
If it takes, you know, $5,000 to $10,000 to evict somebody, you can no longer charge a tenant for that. And so those costs have to go somewhere.
Three other reasons Clemmy cites: property values going up, costing landlords more in property taxes, lumber becoming more expensive, increasing the cost of maintenance and renovations, and general uncertainty about the future of the housing market. He says the best way to get prices to stabilize would be to increase housing supply.
The housing stock isn't being replaced with new building. So really, I think the best way to bring the prices down right now is to build more.
Other big question: are these steep hikes legal, and what should tenants be on the lookout for? I took those questions to a managing attorney for the Northwest Justice Project here in Spokane.
Bad news for renters: there are basically no restrictions on how much landlords can raise your rent.
There is no rent control in Washington state right now, so landlords can charge as much rent as they want, as often as they want.
The only requirements, says Monica Holland, are that they give you proper advance notice of the increase.
Your landlord has to give you 60 days advance notice. It has to be in writing, and the rent increase cannot become effective during the term of your lease. The term of your lease has to end first, and then the rent increase can kick in.
Now, if you're in some sort of subsidized housing, the notice period is shorter.
Those tenants need to only receive 30 days of written notice of a rent increase. So it's really important to know what kind of rental agreement you have.
The moratorium on rent increases just ended on July 1st. That means if your landlord gave you notice on that day, the soonest your rent could go up is August 1st if you're subsidized, or September 1st if not. If they gave you notice after that day, you should get an extra month. And again, rent cannot be increased in the middle of your lease.
All right, one other restriction: if your landlord received rental assistance, that money may have been given to them on the condition that they don't raise your rent. Holland says landlords are required to notify tenants if they're getting such assistance. In the newsroom tonight, Casey Decker, Crime 2 News.
Very interesting. Good information, Casey. Thank you very much. And we do understand it can be very difficult to deal with those unexpected rent increases. So if this is you, if you're in that position, we want to make sure that you have all the resources and information to help. Coming up tonight on Crime 2 News at 6, we will also be breaking down resources from local organizations to help if you do need rent assistance. You can also text the word RENT to 509-448. 2000.
Well, looking ahead, the Spokane Shock returned to Veterans Arena this Saturday for its first home game with 100% capacity and no COVID restrictions. The team says it's ready to pack the house and celebrate with all their fans. And the Shock is off to a great season so far. They've won 4 of their first 6 games. Saturday's game kicks off at 6. You can catch all the action right here on CW22. Crime 2 sports director Brenna Green will be reporting from the sidelines. She will also have all the highlights on Saturday night on Crime 2 News at 10 and 11 o'clock.
In the meantime, spectators are officially banned from Olympic venues. That decision was made this morning after Japan declared a COVID emergency. Japan's prime minister says the state of emergency will go into effect on Monday, and it will last at least through August 22nd. This means the entire Olympic Games, opening on July 23rd and then running through the 8th of August, will all be held entirely under emergency measures with no fans. That's at indoor or outdoor venues. Now, the Paralympics open on August 24th, so it's still unclear if those games will also be affected. All right, crime in Washington is going up, but apparently not all crimes.
Yeah, we're breaking down the data to see what crimes are going up and what crimes are going down. All that information for you next.